This is Patsy with a Z. Welcome to Joy on Paper, a program for writers and those who dream of writing. Today is a special day because this is a pre-Valentine's Day program. And when I was thinking who I wanted to talk to, I thought of the sweetest, the nicest, and the kindest person I have interviewed since I started this program 5 years ago, and somebody who I just love. Layng Martine Jr. is an amazing, amazing author and songwriter. His songs have been recorded by Reba McEntire, Jerry Lee Lewis, the Pointer Sisters, and many others. And of course, Elvis. And the last song that Elvis recorded that was released was a wonderful song called Way Down. And I love that song. And I'm so happy to welcome Layng Martine Jr. back to Joy on Paper. Hi, Layng.
Well, hey, Patsy. That's so sweet to want me back.
Layng, we're breaking up. Can you get closer to your phone or something?
Yeah. Is that any better?
Yeah, that's much better. Okay. Good. We want to hear every word. As I said, it's Valentine's Day coming up, and your book, Permission to Fly, a memoir of love, crushing loss, and triumph, touched me so much when I read it, and so many of my listeners just were so enthralled with the book and with the story of your love and of your beautiful wife, Linda. And I thought, what a better way to celebrate Valentine's Day than to talk a little bit about Linda.
Oh, God, nothing I'd rather talk about.
How many years now have you been married?
This is 56 years. Isn't that amazing?
It is amazing. For people who find their love and just can share it for so many wonderful, wonderful, blessed years, it is a beautiful thing. And I was so impressed with a little article that you wrote, and it's about the situation here during the COVID time and telling people they can find something wonderful even during this terrible time. We're going to play one of your songs. You know, this is a song that's not played often enough, if you ask me. I love this song. It's the Pointer Sisters, and it is a great song. We'll play that, and maybe you can adjust your phone so that you don't break up so much, okay?
You know what, Patsy? It's doubling. When I hear you talk, I hear me. I don't know what's happening.
You don't have your radio on?
No, I don't.
Let's play this song first, and then you can tell us about it, okay?
Okay, sure.
Well, you know, I love this song.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, we hear you better now. Okay.
I love the Pointer Sisters. They just have so much life and so much spirit, and it was an incredible thrill when they recorded that song.
They do it so beautifully. It's one of these songs that when you hear it all day long after I'm going around the house saying, should I do it? Like should I do should I do the laundry or should I, you know?
Oh, God. These people, you know, when I would hear someone on the radio like that and they were just so eaten up with life and what I think of as spirit and just can-do attitude, I just sat there one day and I said I would give my right arm to have those guys record one of my songs. And I just played, I lay down on the floor and I had these detachable speakers and I would just play their albums over and over and over and over. And I think that when I sat down to write a song during that time, that those chords and their rhythms and their spirit and everything was just in me. And that song rolled out really quickly. And the idea that I made this demo, which was it's just an incredibly good demo. The female singer who sang it was just perfect for it. And you know what's really crazy about that, Patsy? That girl charged $50 to sing my demo. $50. And she is so good. She did all the harmony parts and everything. So then I loved this demo so much. And then when they loved it so much, it's the biggest payoff of being a songwriter or being any kind of a writer when somebody that you think is wonderful loves your song or loves your book or anything. The fact that you love my stories and my book, and then you love this essay that I wrote about Linda and my taking these trips, is just such a charge to me. You can't imagine.
I think you are inspirational. Certainly, you know, you suffered tragedy and you overcame it by simply going ahead with life and saying, I'm going to enjoy what I have as much as I can. And that's the right attitude. And I hate, like, when I hear about people being really, really depressed during this pandemic time, because there are things that they can do. And like you do, these wonderful road trips, and you see things that just fill your heart with joy. Whether it's a John Deere tractors, which, you know, coming from my grandfather's farm, I love a John Deere.
Well, it's just so educational. You ride out, we go, it takes about an hour and a half for us to get up into southern Kentucky because we live in Nashville. And when we're there, it's just complete different world from Nashville. And we think probably lots of the people whose houses are we're passing have never been to Nashville and would have no reason to go. You see these gigantic silos and these incredibly expensive tractors, and you realize that people think of a person like that as a farmer, but they've got to be an unbelievable business person. And that sort of gets no play at all. But when these rides and then being together is one fabulous aspect, but all of this eye-opening stuff that we see, or, you know, you go by a field of corn or whatever, and you see a cell tower, and you think, wow, this guy's probably getting $3,000 or $4,000 a month for that cell tower to be on his property. And that helps him so much, you know, and these rides make us think of all kinds of things that aren't generally on our mind. So that's an extra bonus to it.
Well, that's one great thing about having audible books these days, that you can listen in the car really to every book that you can imagine and any kind of book you can imagine. Just getting fresh ideas in your head, thinking about things, is so important, not to just dwell on your own problems or just in general problems, but to look for the beauty of the places around you, and even, you know, stopping for ice cream.
Oh, that's the key thing. But it's fun to have all these little destinations that we know where there are good ice cream, and we know what their specialty ice cream is, and regional stuff. Where in the south of the great barbecue, in the north, where are the great lobster rolls and stuff? And we just get in the car, Patsy, and we already say, so what are you going to get? You know, because it's so exciting that what's waiting at the other end of their trip. It's also incredible to have a buddy. I think, you know, when you're going through really, really difficult times, alone is, if you have a pal or somebody that, you know, preferably someone that you love, that's an extra bonus. But even just a good friend, you know, a good buddy. And I've often thought that, you know, the struggle that Linda and I went through when she was crippled in the car accident and everything, we had each other. We always have had each other, and we've always known that. And
perhaps during this pandemic-y time, people are thinking more about keeping their connections, the people that they love, to their families, and really strengthening their friendships, because they see now that you need people.
My neighborhood is a good example. Like, I have just called up several guys and just said, you know, will you walk on Tuesday, you know? And then it turns out often that we end up walking every Tuesday. And they're different ages. You know, you get to hear, you know, somebody that's in their 30s, like I'm in my high 70s, and someone in their 30s has completely different interests and cares and knowledge. And I I just walked with the one guy. He's probably 45 or something, but you know, his kids are, you know, 15-ish, totally different stage of life from me, and facing all kinds of, you know, internet things with a daughter and all kinds of stuff that I don't. So it just keeps you part of the universe. And I just think the idea of hanging around only with people that are, you've known forever, which is wonderful, but that are just your age or something. Nowhere nearly as educational as the whole spectrum of people.
Exactly. I have wonderful conversations with the guy who does the bagging at my local grocery store. I love him. And we have the greatest talks at 7 o'clock in the morning, because I do my shopping at 7 o'clock in the morning because I can't stand crowds. It's important to your brain cells, actually, you know, to keep this constantly in motion, always learning something new.
And challenge, you know, where you have an opinion or something that I might have at my age, and someone sees it completely differently from their 30s. And, you know, yeah, one guy in our neighborhood, one of the things he does is he looks for people that have something to contribute to their particular end of society. And he's got some of these people on YouTube talking to their world about financial responsibility. And the other day I listened to one of these things, or went on YouTube, and I thought, wow, that is a completely different language from me. And isn't it incredible that, and I looked at it, had 456,000 views or something, and it was pretty new. It's so, there's a hell of a lot of people watching this thing. And I thought, okay, he's teaching them all about money and, you know, taxes and withholding taxes. And one of the things he says is, I never met anybody with two jobs that wouldn't be doing better if they had one good job. I mean, stuff like that. And I think, okay, what are these people doing with their money? So I texted my friend who sponsors these guys, and he said they're investing in their neighborhood. And they're, you know, buying apartment buildings or shops or something and renting it to their neighbors. And, you know, they trust each other because they're from the same neighborhood and the same have the same worldview. And so they're going to be responsible to each other. The landlord's going to do a good job taking care of them. And the other guys are going to pay their rent and all kinds of. Anyway, that was something that I just saw on YouTube last week. And I never would have known this kind of stuff was going on and finding a way, not just with an ad from somebody on TV that may or may not communicate with these people, but these are people who are from this neighborhood speaking to their neighbors, and their neighbors or people from similar backgrounds, and helping them. And it's incredibly, you know, exciting to me, but also fascinating to see that it was going on.
It's great. You know, it's just knowing more people and learning new things are always great. And when I announced that you were going to be on, my listeners send me these wonderful emails because they just love you. The song Abilene meant something to you. It triggered something in you.
Yeah. Do you know that song?
Yeah, sure. Everybody loves that song. Abilene. What is it?
Yeah.
So my listener asked, what happened when you heard that song? Was it a thrill for you to realize that you could write?
Well, you know, it's so funny. Somebody's got a darn good memory. That is in my book. And it was a summer I was painting houses, and I had a little transistor radio in the gutter next to me. And while I was painting up on a ladder, and that song came on, Abilene. And I just remember thinking, God, that is just such a wonderful song. I wonder if I could write a song. And I really just said, yeah, you know, I could do that. I understand how that song is built and what the structure is to that song. So I just started writing songs, and that was the beginning of it. So that would have been the summer of 1963. So however many million years ago that is, 68 years ago or something? I don't know. But it was a seminal moment where I just said, that makes me feel so good. If I could ever write a song that someone would like, that would be the greatest feeling going. So.
And the thing is, you weren't a musician. You weren't trying to be like a singer or something. You just felt within you that you could write.
Yeah, and my mom had been a writer, Patsy. My mom was a writer who had stories in every woman's magazine you could possibly name. And so she and Words, and we had five kids in our family. I was the oldest. But she and Words and everything to do with affection and expressing affection, expressing emotion, touching, all the things that we know are so critical. That was, my mom was loaded with that. And so being a writer of some kind or another wasn't foreign to me because I had seen her doing it. And so I really just began walking around my neighborhood singing songs, writing these songs. And because we lived near New York City, when I got a couple of songs, I guess, probably two or three, I just thought, you know, in order to go anywhere with this, I would love someone to record it. But for that to happen, I've got to go and to a music center and try to find people who do music for a living. And because I read all the music magazines and the fan magazines and stuff, I knew that there was one bar in particular on Broadway in New York called the Turf Bar that all the music people went to, the songwriters and musicians and record producers and stuff. And so I was going to Columbia, which is, 66 blocks or so from there. And one day I just said, if you're ever going to, you know, get anywhere but just sing in your neighborhood, you got to do this. So I went down to that bar, and I did not have the guts to go in that bar for two or three days, two or three different tries. And one day I just said, I've got to go in here. And I went in there, and I just found some people that looked like they might be musical people. And I asked them if they knew where I could record a song. And they said, well, what instrument do you play? And I said, well, I don't play an instrument. And they said, well, how do you write songs? Does that song have music? The guy said, and I said, yeah. And he said, well, how does it have music if you don't play anything? And I said, well, I just sing it. And he said, in the air? And I said, yeah. He thought that was hysterical. But he told me where to go. And I think for $80, I was able to hire bass, drums, and guitar and a piano. And I made my first demo, and it just totally hooked me, Pat. I mean, I heard my voice coming out of that speaker, and I thought, this is it. I have got to do this. And I just, so that was my awakening. But yes, you're right. I didn't play an instrument in the beginning. I had no musical training at all. I couldn't read. I still can't read music. I can barely tune my guitar. It's just something that was just sort of in my blood. It turned out to be just in my blood or something.
Well, you know, it's just so exciting always when I tell my listeners, when I say, you know, I'm going to be talking to Layng Martine Jr., and they just sort of jump at it. And of course, they all remember. And, you know, just in January, I had been thinking about Elvis, and I want to play again, Way Down, and because this time, usually because I don't have a lot of time on the program, and sometimes I sort of cut things down, but I want to play the entire song because people really have asked me, they just want to hear it while you're listening to it, knowing that you, you know, Layng Martine Jr. himself, you know, is listening to this wonderful, and it must just still thrill you when you hear your song being sung by Elvis.
Oh, I mean, I just can't believe it. I absolutely cannot believe that ever happened because, as I say right in the beginning of my book, I was in seventh grade and heard that Heartbreak Hotel for the first time, and I just thought, well, this is just a life-changing thing. I went and bought the album, brought it to school and looked at it and showed it to all the, you know. Then to hear him, I think it was 20 years later, sitting in that recording studio, hearing that song play that he was singing, it just seemed a total, I mean, how does that happen? That's just impossible.
Well,
but it
still gives me chills just to listen to it. So here we'll go ahead, you know, we're going to go ahead and listen to the song, knowing that you're listening makes it all the more exciting, okay? Here.
Thank you.
Babe, you get closer. The lights are going dim. The sound of your breathing has made the mood I'm in. All of my resistance lying.
Believe that guy can hit that note, God, way down. God.
I know. I know. It's amazing. That's of course, that was J.D. Sumner, who could do that. Not many people can do that.
Yeah. No, I think he's just one of the very few that was ever recorded doing it. I think he was in the Guinness Book of World Records for that. Maybe changed by now, but it's kind of unbelievable. Tampa, a wild place now, having won the Super Bowl. That was just so exciting.
Oh wow. Tampa went, well, of course, you know, in the pandemic, we can't go as wild as we used to. And I'm sure all of the sports bars and every place were really sad that, you know, they couldn't be at full occupancy, because they certainly could have. And that was a fantastic game.
And yesterday, did you see Tom Brady throw the ball from one boat to another, throw the trophy? Oh my God. Imagine if that had fallen into the water. Oh, God. Well, listen, you're wonderful to have me. I just think it's just such a fabulous spirit that you've got, that you spread out to people. And I know it's going all the time, you know, in between these long times when we're not talking. But, God, it's fabulous to just hear your energy.
My mother used to wake up with a song in her heart, really, literally, with a song in her heart. And she would start singing in the mornings. And she and I, as you probably saw, I sent you an email early in the morning. I still get up like at 4:30. I'm like the farm girl. And so I get up and I still have a song in my heart because of her. You see how important, like your mother was such an influence on you. And my mother, with this same cheerful attitude and... So it was just, I want to imbue this in people and say, look for the joy and look for the happiness. And our life wasn't easy. We were very poor when I was a kid. I mean, very poor, because you come from a very privileged family. You were rich and you had, your grandfather was a representative, right, in Congress.
He was a banker. Well, he was a congressman. God, you have a good memory. Well, yes, he was a congressman.
It's important that we bring music into the world, and partly because of you, I've started to, you know, occasionally play songs on my program. And I want to introduce you today to somebody, a young songwriter, because I know you love to encourage people. And a couple months ago, I was sent her song, and I played it. I fell in love with it, just like I fell in love with your songs, that they just make me feel good. I just happy. And so I have on the line somebody who'd like to say hello to you. Her name is Haley Woolbright. Hi, Haley. Are you there?
Hi, Layng. Hi.
How are you? So you're
I'm
eating
great.
Up a song, huh?
Yeah, and I have really, I've been listening the whole half hour here, and I just downloaded your book on Audible, actually, and I can't wait to listen to it.
Well, you know, I spent my life making demos and, you know, trying to, you know, do my best to sell my song. It was very interesting, too. It took 3 months, Haley. That's how long it took. So many tries to get it right, but I'm sure you have that same thing when you're doing songs. I mean, when you really care about it, it doesn't always happen quickly to get it perfectly as you want it. How long have you been writing?
Exactly, and when it does, it's the best. I've been writing. I mean, really, my whole life that's always been my strength. But it wasn't until I picked up the guitar when I was about 17 to learn how to play guitar that I was like, huh. Maybe I could write songs to go along with this. You know, I've always liked writing in school. Maybe I could write songs. And so I'm 25 now. So do the math there, 17, 25. I've been really intentionally songwriting since then.
Well, you know what? One of the things that always interested me is lots of my friends who are writers are wonderful instrumentalists, but not everybody. And I'm definitely one of those who's not. But if you can get the rhythms and the chords and the notes, you can sing them to people. If you can play just a few chords, you can sing them to people who can, you know, play them better. You may be good enough to play your own, which is kind of the ultimate. And once in a blue moon, I did that. But basically, I think it's encouraging to know that, you know, you don't have to be the greatest guitar player, piano player, or whatever. It's the feeling and the rhythm and the chords and the way the notes fall over the chords. I mentioned, as you may be a great instrumentalist, but I think it's interesting that you don't necessarily have to be.
Exactly.
No, I love that.
You know, Layng, I want to play the song that I decided to put Haley on the program. So listen in, and we'll talk about it when we finish. Boxcar. And, you know, I think she's been listening to you. Here, let's go ahead and we'll listen to Boxcar.
Let's hear it. Love to hear it.
Company's gone. I could choose to step off and make my way back home, or I could choose to keep moving on. My time is come and gone. Maybe I'll stay my welcome, but I've outgrown this boxcar and I'm headed down the I've been traveling along for the ride. Colored the Smokies, braved the Rockies, and rolled the hills of the countryside. But things change and people do too. This freight train has run its course. I'm still gonna make it out west, so I'll hop on a new line with no remorse. My time is
Layng, what do you think?
Boy, you made a great, I think she made an amazing demo of that. God, and, you know, and you, your rhythms, did you sing it?
Yeah, that's hers. That's
I did,
her voice.
Yeah.
You know, she is a she is a newlywed. And the guy she wrote this song about, she dumped.
And, oh, no.
Yeah, good. Good riddance, you know, good riddance.
But he served his purpose.
But he served his purpose. And now
he did. He did.
Now she's a newlywed. And I was thinking, you know, here we have a newlywed songwriter. And you, who have now have 55 years of being married to Linda, who is such a wonderful, giving woman and who's kept you going for all this time. I thought for Valentine's Day, that's an inspiration for people to know that in Haley's case, she dumped that guy, got over him, find herself a new guy, and, you know, she's on the way, right?
Well, yeah.
Yes, it is.
Getting dumped or dumping is very emotional, and that's what works in songs.
Yeah, I got a whole album out of it.
Patsy, you know, if you would, give Haley my contact info, and she could. I'd love for you to send me the song or send me a couple or whatever, and, you know, we can communicate. If you ever come to Nashville, Haley, please call me. I'd love to have coffee. I'll tell you anything I know and do anything I could possibly do to help you.
Right. That would be amazing.
And she's a St. Louis girl.
I would love to get to know you.
Right?
Oh, is that you're in St. Louis? Oh,
I am in St. Louis,
hours. You know, if you do come down, things are generally better, you know, obviously face-to-face, and you can sit and have coffee or lunch or something, and you've obviously got
I will take you up on that.
Yeah, take me up, and please do. Because honestly and truly, there's nothing more exciting to me than young people that have drive and excitement and dreams. And I'm honest to God, like last Saturday, I took this young couple to breakfast, and they were like 22 or something. And I mean, like the third question I asked them is, what are your hopes and dreams? Because I think that just tells you so much about somebody.
Mm.
And especially if they don't have any. Because having them is the key to just the excitement and the possibilities. And you've got, obviously, I mean, you've done a lot, you can't write a song as well as that if you don't really have busted your tail at it.
Well,
thank you.
So tell me, the two of you, what are you going to do for Valentine's Day? Do you have a special special thing that you're doing?
Well, so Haley, go. You newlyweds, what are you guys going to do?
Okay. I just got my first gig on Valentine's Day in like months because of COVID. You know, no place has had live music, so I haven't been gigging. And there's a place here where I live that is like trying to open up live music again, and they just booked me for their Valentine's Day special. So, you know, I asked my husband, I'm like, it's our first Valentine's Day together. Is it okay? Like, can I take this gig? It's in the middle of the day. And he was like, you haven't had a gig in months. Like, you got to take it. You know, we'll go out to dinner afterwards. Like, do it. And because he's so supportive. He's not a musician. He's the farthest thing from a musician. But he's, you know, so supportive. So I get to play a gig, and then we'll get some dinner.
Yeah, that's so nice. So that sounds like a wonderful evening.
Yeah.
It's also good to have someone who's not in the music business too. I mean, there are all ways to do it, and plenty of people are where they both are. But I found it very helpful that Linda wasn't, you know, eaten up with it. And we were a family. When we were together, it's not all about, you know, one of our songs or one of our, it was about our family.
I could not agree more. I could not agree more. What are you doing?
Well, Haley, we do what we do kind of every day, especially during the winter. We go on these rides together and listen to books, and then we come home and often do a little quiet time thing, which could be reading or taking a nap or whatever. But then we make a fire. We sit by the fire, and we have our little glass of wine, and then we make dinner, and then we watch these romantic movies, which are getting harder to find because we've seen so many of them, but we're constantly looking for more. But that's kind of our
that's little awesome. It'll be
same thing on Valentine's Day.
And that's what you'll be doing 55 years from now, Haley.
Yeah.
I was
just
about to say, I hope that's what we're doing, you know, 50 years down the line. That sounds amazing.
Now,
the thing, all the different stages of life are certain, because, you know, for so many, we had three boys, and for so long, it's,
it's just all about, you know, the things to do with the family and everything. And then you kind of do have to reinvent yourself, as everybody does. And then in a way, double with this car accident thing. And so, but, you know, to wake up each day now, because I'm 78, and we can do anything we want. And we usually want to do that together and invent something. And we just have found like 8 billion things that are pretty simple to do that are achievable. You know, it can't be like, you can't go to Italy every day or something, but you can go to some interesting little town, you know, in, you know, Western Tennessee or Southern Kentucky for us, or in New England where we go a lot, you know, in Massachusetts where we've never been. And it's simple, but it's an adventure, just like, but it's achievable. I think it's so important. And like, you really can have a fabulous cheeseburger every day for lunch if you want to, you know, it's achievable. It's not just something that's like, if only I get an Elvis Presley record or something. No, that's not where the thing that's right. Wonderful. A little magical, simple, everyday stuff.
And Haley,
I love that.
Have you written a love song for your new hubby?
I have, and I'm excited to actually say for the first time publicly that I have a new song coming out on March 11th. It's called Long Game, and this is like the first song that I've written and dedicated for my husband. Fun fact, we got engaged in November of 2019, you know, and then we're engaged going into 2020, and we were supposed to get married in September of 2020, a couple months ago. And last May, we found out that our venue was like rescheduling it. They were like, we have to push it back a year because of COVID. And so we were like, well, we don't want to do that. We want to get married. So we got married in our backyard, like a little small ceremony, you know, months before we had even planned to. And, you know, we're having our reception still this coming May, you know, kind of like a party a year later. But we went ahead and just got married with our parents and siblings in the backyard. And the whole thing about this song was, when we got engaged, I said last January, I started writing the secret song. I was like, you know what? He's been such a good sport. He's come to all my gigs for so long and listened to me sing songs about other boys from the past, you know, past breakups. He's been such a good sport about it, but I don't have a song for him. And so I said, you know what? I'm going to write and record secretly throughout our engagement. I started this last January, a song that is for him, and I'm going to get it recorded by our September wedding so that on our wedding, I can like have it for him. He can play it. You know, I can pull it up on Spotify and be like, hey, this is your song I wrote for you. So I was doing that. I was writing it, and I was in talks with my producer, and we were trying to get it figured out. And then, of course, COVID hit. So I couldn't go to the recording studio. We ended up getting married earlier than thought, so I couldn't finish the song. So I just had to tell him, hey, this is what I've been doing the past 6 months. I ended up just playing it to him on my acoustic guitar. But now that things are kind of, you know, leveling out, I've finally gotten to go to work on this song again. And so on March 11th, he'll finally get to hear his wedding present.
Well, tune in on March 11th and hear it.
It's wonderful. The two of you are doing something so wonderful. When I started this program, I thought I was, you know, I'm talking to, you know, people who write books. And of course, Layng, you wrote a book. But then I realized, too, when Haley came along, she doesn't have a book, but she's writing. Those are words. Lyrics are words. And you're giving to the world a wonderful gift, both of you. You're giving joy. And all I have to do is play one of your songs, and I feel better. You have spirit and you have heart and soul that you put into this music. And we are all very, very, all of my listeners are very grateful to both of you.
Well, that's so nice. I think Haley and I are getting the best end of the deal, but you're very, very sweet. Thank you, Ben. What a pleasure.
No, I really do appreciate that.
Well, I hope you guys get together at some point, and I'm sure that you will find a lot to talk about. Haley, I know you're going to enjoy Layng's book. Layng, a special, special thank you for you know, to come back to Joy on Paper again, and just hearing your voice makes me happy, and it's been an honor always when you come on Joy on Paper.
Well, thank you, Patsy. You're such a treasure, and I hope I get to meet you someday. And will you please give my contact info to Haley so that if she ever wants to come down or communicate in any way, she has it?
I will. Absolutely, Layng. Great. Thank you both so much for being on Joy on Paper today. Happy Valentine's Day to you and to your loved ones, and just have a great, great every day of your life. Find that, you know, joy, not just joyful, joy-filled. Fill your life with joy.
Yeah. Oh, well, love you guys. You're both such treasures. I hope we get to meet, really, because you're extremely special and just over the wires.
Oh, well, thank you, Layng.
I second that.
Okay, well, bye-bye to both of you. Bye-bye, Layng Martine Jr.
Thank you.
And his book is available on Amazon. And please, people, get it. It's a wonderful book, and it will really make you think. It'll make you think, and it'll make you really appreciate this wonderful, wonderful songwriter who has filled our heart with joy. Bye-bye now, Layng.
Bye, Patsy. Bye, Haley.
Okay.
Bye.
Okay, bye-bye, Haley. Bye. This has been fun because, you know, I wanted to give them a chance to meet and talk, and I thought that would be fun for them. You know, Layng, of course, loves to help young people, and Haley's just starting off in the business, and I know one day she's going to be winning a Grammy Award there, and I will see her going up on the red carpet. So I just wanted to bring them together, and because it's Valentine's Day, it's a very special day. Bye-bye, everybody.